Well, in the past couple of years, one crime not often seen in New Hampshire has become more prominent.
Human trafficking seems like something that would be an international issue, but the truth is it's happening in small towns all over. Tonight, our Heather Hamill investigates the crime and why it's often overlooked.
You will do whatever we say, whenever we say.
Forced into being a sex slave at only 15 years old.
If you tell anybody, you're dead. We'll kill your brothers if you go to anybody.
It was a nightmare she couldn't escape. Teresa Flores is a survivor of human trafficking, something you've probably heard of, but think, not here. But local experts and prosecutors say it is happening in the Granite State in many different forms.
It's really a problem that's in plain sight. It's hiding in plain sight, and it's just recognizing the signs.
Globally, there are an estimated 27 million victims of trafficking, as many as 17,000 in the U.S. In the past 5 years, a national tip line received about 100 calls from New Hampshire. In fact, the second ever jury conviction under the federal forced labor laws was here in Litchfield. Two owners of a tree cutting service were sent to federal prison for forcing four Jamaican men to work for them and live in a tool shed and trailer with inadequate heating and plumbing. Trafficking can be anything from immigrants being kept in unsanitary conditions and ordered to work for little pay to forced prostitution.
But I don't think that I for once thought to tell somebody because those threats were so high.
Teresa Flores recently visited New Hampshire to share her story in an effort to help people recognize and put an end to trafficking. In high school, living in an affluent community near Detroit, Flores had a crush on a boy at school. One day, she accepted a ride home from him, but he took her to his house and drugged her and raped her. Days later, he showed her pictures of the assault and told her she'd have to earn those pictures back.
Never would have crossed my mind anything that they had in store for me.
The boy and a group of men forced her into prostitution, something she hid from her family as she tried to maintain a normal life.
Meeting them several nights a week, usually in my pajamas and barefooted, and being driven to different houses, very affluent houses all around the Detroit area. You know, it was never less than three men a night, probably an average of six.
Flores says she tried dropping little signs of what was going on, but nobody noticed. Prosecutors here say that's one problem. Not even law enforcement officials may know what to look for, and even if they do, they're not sure what action to take. Earlier this year, the Attorney General's office created a commission to combat trafficking.
The approach of the commission is a multidisciplinary approach to engage the community, and it's victim-centered, which means we're focusing on the victim. We're not looking at, say, a teen victim who is engaging in commercial sex acts. We're not looking at them as prostitutes. We're looking at them as victims.
Hillsborough County Attorney Patricia LaFrance says awareness is key. She points to a case in 2011 where her office prosecuted a Nashua man for prostitution. In reality, she believes the crime fit the definition of trafficking. LaFrance says a 14-year-old runaway had met a 25-year-old woman who got her hooked on cocaine and heroin. The woman then brought the girl to the home of 79-year-old Paul Kea.
Essentially, this older woman was engaging in sex acts in exchange for drugs and money supplied by Paul Kea. And eventually, she lured the 14-year-old girl into doing essentially the same thing.
New Hampshire did pass a human trafficking statute in 2009. The crime is a Class A felony with enhanced penalties if the victim is younger than 18. But the nonprofit that runs the National Trafficking Hotline says that's not enough, giving the Granite State a low rating when it comes to legislative action.
This year, New Hampshire was in the bottom tier, and by the point system, was second to last, only above South Dakota.
Corey Smith, a UNH law school professor, is also the policy counsel for the Alliance to End Slavery and Trafficking, and he sits on New Hampshire's commission.
The trafficking cases are extremely complicated. You need specialized skills. They can be expensive because of the complicated nature of the cases, and you deal with criminal enterprises that are very sophisticated and also international, global in scope.
In New Hampshire right now, one area of concern is the I-95 corridor between Massachusetts and Maine. Investigators say it's easy to move victims through there, back and forth to bigger cities. In January 2011, police in Portsmouth investigated what they called a multi-state trafficking ring. It involved a teenager being forced into prostitution from a hotel room. There were at least four related arrests in New Jersey. Teresa Flores says she was once sold from one group of men to another and repeatedly assaulted. She escaped the men and soon after escaped trafficking altogether because her father's job transferred them to Connecticut. She calls herself lucky because most victims never get out.
This can happen in any zip code, and it is, to any kid. We really need to wake up and become aware that this is happening everywhere in the United States. It just looks different than what we've thought human trafficking looks like.
For News 9 Investigates, I'm Heather Hamill.